Welcome everyone to our Autumn Teatime Tales, and thank you for joining us today. My name is Beverley Casebow from the National Library of Scotland, and I'm here with storyteller Anne Hunter. So I know that we have people joining us today from all around the world, from Australia, from the US and Canada, Jamaica. So maybe where you are, it's hot and sunny, but certainly in Scotland, the days are getting a little colder and darker. And it's definitely the time of year for cozying in, coorieing in, to share some stories and songs and tunes. So that's what we're going to do this afternoon. And Anne and I will be here for a while after the stories. So if you have anything to ask us, any thoughts or comments or riddles, we do like riddles, you can type them into the chat box and we'll pick them up at the end. But we're going to start with a riddle and a welcome from Anne.
Hello there. So my riddle, I think, is maybe quite easy and you might get it, but let's see. In spring, I am gay, dressed in comely array. In summer, more clothing I wear. When colder it grows, I fling off my clothes, and in winter, quite naked appear. What am I? I'll say it one more time, and then I'll tell you. So in spring, I am gay, dressed in in summer, more clothing I wear. When colder it grows, I fling off my clothes, and in winter, quite naked appear. What am I? Well, I think some of you may already have guessed that I am a tree. And because the trees are such beautiful colours already here in Scotland, we've been thinking about trees a lot. And we've got a little poem here to follow on from the riddle, which is by a poet called Mandy Haggett. And Beverly's going to start the poem.
And the birch says, it's about dancing and colour.
And the rowan says, it's about berries and birds.
And the willow says, it's about shape and shelter.
And the hazel says, it's about love and lichen.
And the aspen says, it's about growth and the wind.
But we say, it's about listening to the trees. So listening to the trees is a good introduction to my next story, which is actually originally from Estonia, but this version of it is set in Scotland, and it's about a farmer called Hamish, and it's called Hamish and the Trees. Now, one autumn day, Hamish was walking through the woods, because at this time of year, he would always gather in a good stack of wood ready for the winter, so that he always had a good fire in the winter. Now, he could have just gathered up the wood that had been blown from the trees by the autumn winds, but he couldn't be bothered with that. He had his axe with him, and he came to a tree which he thought would be fine, and he would be able to chop it down and have a good stack of wood. And he threw back his axe and he went chop, and a voice said, stop, don't chop me down. Hamish was astonished. What, a talking tree? Yes, said the tree. And why should I not chop you down? Because I'm a birch tree. You know how you make your baskets out of my bark and your brooms from my branches. No birch tree, no baskets and no brooms. Ah, thought Hamish, sure enough, I need my baskets and broom, so I won't chop you down. Thank you, said the birch tree. Remember, Hamish, if you look after us, we'll look after you. So Hamish went on his way. He went a bit further and he came to a great tall tree and he thought, well, this will be even better. I'll have wood right up to the spring. And he threw back his axe and he went, chop! And a voice said, stop, don't chop me down. Why should I not chop you down? Because I'm an oak tree. Remember, Hamish, how much your pigs feed off all my thousands of acorns. No oak tree, no fat pigs. That's right, thought Hamish. And so he said, okay, he wouldn't chop the oak tree down. And the oak tree said, thank you, Hamish. Remember, if you look after the trees, we'll look after you. So Hamish went a bit further until he found another likely tree, smaller, but he thought it would keep him going for a while. And I think you can do the actions with me. He put back his axe and he went, chop. Don't chop me down, stop, said the tree. And why ever should I not chop you down? Asked Hamish. Because I'm a cherry tree. And you know how much you like cherry pie, Hamish. Hamish loved cherry pie. Okay, I won't chop you down then. Thank you, Hamish. Remember, if you look after the trees, we'll look after you. And again, Hamish went on through the wood till he came to a tree with beautiful leaves. And he thought, this will be fine. Even though it had beautiful leaves, he still wanted to chop it down. So he threw back his axe. Chop! Stop! Don't chop me down. And why should I not chop you down? Because I'm a chestnut tree. Hamish, you know how much you like roasted chestnuts, roasting chestnuts by the fire in the winter. Hamish loved roasted chestnuts. Okay, I won't chop you down. And the tree said, remember, Hamish, if you look after the trees, we'll look after you. Well, Hamish went right through that wood, and every tree he came across had a reason not to cut it down. And at last, Hamish, he thought, what can I do? He sat down at a tree trunk. He scratched his head. He thought, I'll just have to gather up the wood and not use my axe at all. And as soon as he thought that, out from behind a tree popped a tiny wee man. He was all dressed in green. He had a jacket made out of birch bark, and the trousers were made of birch leaves. And on his head, he had an acorn hat. And his shoes were made of thistle down. Thank you, Hamish, he said. Thank you for being kind to nature. And because of that, nature will be kind to you. If you ever need any help, just call on the birds or the bees or anything in nature, and nature will help you. If you want fruit, ask the birds and they will bring you some. And Hamish was very pleased with this gift that the little man said he could have. And the little man was just turning to go, but then he turned back and said, remember, Hamish, you must never ask for anything that goes against nature. That would be the wrong thing to do. Remember that, Hamish. And Hamish said that he would, and they parted. And Hamish, he gathered up wood as he made his way back through the wood. And eventually he got home and he had quite a good stack of wood. But by now he was tired and hungry. And he thought perhaps he would try and see if nature would help him. So he said, birds, birds, please bring me some fruit. And there was a twittering and a fluttering, and in no time at all, birds came flying through the window with berries in their beaks, and they dropped them into Hamish's bowl. Some of the berries were quite tart, So Hamish thought he would need some honey, and he said, "Bees, bees, bring me some honey." Of course, it was the autumn, so there weren't that many bees, but in a little while, there came flying through a lovely bee with a beautiful honeycomb dripping with honey. And Hamish put it on his fruit. And it went on like that. Whenever he needed any help, he would ask nature for it. When spring came round and he needed the fields ploughing, he shouted of the moles. And in no time at all, thousands of moles had turned over all the soil. And then when it was ready to plant, he called on the pigeons and they planted all the seed. It was wonderful. And you know, it meant that Hamish didn't need anybody to help him anymore. He didn't even have to do very much work himself. I'm afraid that Hamish became a wee bit lazy and a little bit arrogant. And the year turned and it came to the winter. And it was one of those winter days, not icy cold, but dark and damp and drizzly and dreek, heavy cloud cover. Hamish hated that kind of day. And without even thinking, he looked up at the clouds and he said, "Sun, make it hot, hot, hot." Of course, Hamish shouldn't have asked that of the sun, for it was the middle of winter. It was going against nature, but it was too late. He'd already said it. And the clouds parted and the sun began to shine down, a strong beam of hot sun that got stronger and stronger, and it was hotter and hotter and hotter. But it wasn't shining everywhere. It was shining just on Hamish. And all of a sudden, in a puff of smoke, Hamish disappeared. Some people say that Hamish reappeared and eventually recovered. But of course, he could never ask nature for help again. And the trees never spoke again. But it said, and I believe this, I think I've experienced it, that if you go into the wood or the forest and sit quietly amongst the trees, sometimes you can still hear them whispering, "If you look after the trees, we'll look after you." And that's the end of my story, Hamish and the Trees.
Thank you, Anne, for that lovely story. Now, this time of year, when it's getting a bit darker and colder, I find anyway that it's easy to feel a bit sleepy at this time in the afternoon. So we're just going to check that you're awake and alert for the next story with another riddle. So the answer to this riddle is something that you would definitely need in Scotland at this time of the year. You go in through one hole, but you come out through three holes. When you're inside, you're ready to go out. But when you're outside, you're still inside. What is it? I'll say it again because it's a bit complex. You go in through one hole, but you come out through three holes. When you're inside, you're ready to go outside. But when you're outside, you're still inside. Well, I'm not going to give you the answer to that right away. You can think about it while we have our next story, which Anne and I are going to tell together. Now, behind me, I don't know if you can see, but on the table, I've got a jug of purple heather, which I collected quite recently when I was up in the West Highlands. And our next story comes from that part of Scotland. It was told by the great traveller storyteller, Duncan Williamson, but it's been passed down to Anne and myself by two other storytellers, Andy Hunter and David Campbell. There were once two brothers, Donald and Archie, who lived on a croft in the west of Scotland. Now, Donald, he was the older of the two, and he liked to be in charge. He was the boss. And Archie, the younger one, he seemed to do all the hard work around the farm. I hope if you've got older brothers and sisters that they're not like Donald, because all day he'd be saying, Archie, do this. Archie, do that. Poor Archie. He was up at the crack of dawn every day, milking the cows, sweeping out the byre, feeding the hens and the chickens and the pigs, raking the hay, mending the fences, anything and everything that needed to be done on the farm. And for all that hard work, Donald gave him sixpence every week, six old pennies, which even in those days wasn't very much. Well, the two brothers also kept some sheep, which grazed on the hillside above the croft. And there were some stone walls, or stane dykes, as they're called in Scotland, which helped to keep the sheep from straying too far from home. One day, Donald and Archie were up on the hill repairing these stane dykes. And I don't know if you've ever seen walls like this, but they're very skillfully made because there's no cement or mortar involved holding them together. It's just the careful placing and positioning of each stone so that everything is in perfect balance. As you might guess, it was Donald who was supervising this work. And it was Archie who was doing all the heavy lifting and carrying and running around the hillside getting the stones. It was really hard work, and Archie was longing for a rest. But fortunately, at that moment, a traveller man came on the path down the hill towards them, and both Donald and Archie stopped what they were doing to talk to him. For in those days, that's how people got their news. Before the days of television and radio, and long, long before computers, it was the travelling people and the tradesmen, like tailors, who went from village to village and place to place, carrying the news and the stories and songs and sometimes the gossip with them. So the three of them stood talking for a while, and then the traveller turned to Donald and he said, "Would you mind if I took some of the heather that's growing here on the hill?" "Take as much as you want," said Donald. "It's no use to us. Help yourself." And so the traveller began pulling up the purple heather. And Donald went back to looking at the wall, but Archie, he was very curious. And he watched the traveller man pulling up the heather, and he followed him around for a while, and then he said, What would you be needing all that heather for?" "Why, I'm making heather brooms," said the traveller, "heather besoms. That's what I do. I make heather brooms and I take them round door to door and sell them, and I get a little bit of money every day." "Oh," said Archie, "is it easy to make a heather besom?" "Oh, it's very easy," said the traveller. "You just gather some heather together in a bunch, and you find a pole or a stick, or maybe a hazel branch, and you put it down the middle, and you tie everything together tightly with some string, and you trim off the edges, and there you have it, a besom." And how long would it take you to make such a thing?" asked Archie. 20 minutes, half an hour," said the traveller. "I can make three or four in a day, and make them in the morning, sell them in the afternoon." "And how much would you sell such a thing for?" asked Archie. "Well, maybe 1 shilling," 2 shillings, depending on the size. 2 shillings, said Archie. 2 silver shillings. Why, that's 4 times as much as I get for a whole week's work on the farm. Just then, Donald's voice came crying over the hill. Archie! Archie! Enough of your blethering now. We've got work to do. Come, get me this stone here. No, said Archie. No, I'm not working for you anymore. Not working for me? What do you mean? Said Donald. I'm going into business on my own, said Archie. Business? What kind of business are you going into? I'm going into the besom making business. Archie, come on. You don't know how to make besoms, said Donald. I do. The traveller man told me how to make them, said Archie. He said it was very easy. Archie, these people have been making besoms for generations. They know what they're doing. You don't know how to make a besom. You've never made one. But Archie was determined, and so he left Donald and he went around the hillside pulling up the purple heather. And when he thought he had enough, he went back to the croft and he found his old shepherd's crook with the curved handle. And he cut off the top. I won't be needing that anymore, he thought. And he gathered the heather together, just as the traveller man had shown him, and he put his shepherd's crook down the middle, and he found some string and bound it all together tightly. And then he got his knife and he hacked away at the heather. And there it was, Archie's first besom. Well, it was a big, big, ugly thing. It was bushy and straggly and twice the size of a normal broom, but Archie was very proud of it. And he propped it up against the farmhouse wall and he stood back and admired it. And then Archie saw that Donald was coming back from the hill. What's that? Said Donald. It's my besom, said Archie. I'm taking it down to the village to sell it. You're not selling that in the village. You're not going near the village with that thing, said Donald, shaming our family and me an elder of the church. But when Donald wasn't looking, Archie took the besom and he went down to the village. He knocked on the door of the very first house and a young woman answered. Yes, she said. I was wondering if you might like to buy a besom, said Archie. Well, yes, I do have need for a new broom, she said. Let me have a look. And Archie proudly showed her his besom. It's not quite what I was looking for, she said, and she closed the door. And although Archie went from house to house, he got the same response everywhere he went. And he thought he would have to turn back and go back to the croft and face Donald, and he knew Donald would laugh and he didn't want to go back. But then he remembered there was one last house in the village. It was right at the edge. He'd almost forgotten it was there. And so he took his besom and he went towards it.
And as he was walking towards it, it looked quite hopeful because there were chickens pecking in the yard and there was smoke coming from the lump from the chimney. But Archie was feeling a wee bit downhearted because of all the rejection of his fine besom, as he thought. So he hid the besom behind his back before he knocked on the door of the house. Then he gave a smart tap and the door opened. And there was a woman who was very short in stature, but what she made What she lacked in height, she made up for in girth. She almost filled the doorway. But she had the most welcoming smile, and she said, "What can I do for you, young man?" "Well, I wondered if you would like to buy a besom." "Have you got one? A real heather besom?" Because, of course, Archie still had the besom behind his back, but now he brought it out and showed her. And when she set eyes on it, her eyes lit up. "That's a magnificent besom," she said. "How much do you want for it?" "Well, I was thinking a shilling," said Archie. "A shilling? I'll give you 2 shillings for it. It's a wonderful besom." And so the deal was done. She gave him the 2 shillings, and Archie gave her the besom, and he set off back down the hill. He was so happy, he felt like skipping. He couldn't wait to tell Donald the whole story. But what Archie didn't know was that the woman that he'd just sold the besom to was a witch. Maggie was her name. Some people, quite uncharitably, called her Fat Maggie. She was the most powerful witch in the land. But even so, she never went to the witches' gatherings because she had never found a besom sturdy enough to carry her. But she was very hopeful about this one. And she put her legs athwart it and she gave a few circuits of the kitchen, and she was as pleased as punch. Now it just so happened that the night of that very day, there was to be a great gathering of witches in a birch wood on the west coast of Scotland. It was a full moon that night. It was a bright moonlit night. And as usual, the witches flew down and gathered in that birch wood, and they were chatting and talking and a little bit of gossip and a few jokes, like any normal gathering. Sometimes they weren't very kind, and one witch said, "Ha! I don't suppose we'll be seeing Fat Maggie tonight. She's never had a broom that could carry her." But just at that moment, something passed over the face of the moon, and a shadow fell on the gathering of witches, and they all looked up. And there they saw Maggie circling down right into the center of them. "Ha! So, Fat Maggie, is it?" she said. "And Fat Maggie won't have a broom big enough to carry her, will she not? I'll show you. I'll let you know what's what." And she said, "Yous will not be flying home tonight, but I will." And with a sweep of her hand and a powerful spell, she gathered up all the witch's besoms. And then with a lash of her arm and another spell, she threw them high into the birch trees. And Maggie was the most powerful witch in the land, so none of them could get them down. All the other witches had to walk home that night. And if you look into birch trees, sometimes to this day, you will see in the west coast of Scotland, and even here in the east, because Maggie threw them a long, long way, you can see tangles of twigs that are called witches' besoms or witches' brooms, because nobody has ever been able to get them down again. But Maggie did fly home that night, and Archie had a very satisfied customer for many years to come. And that's the end of the story of Archie's besom. And I think now Beverley might be going to tell you the answer to that quite difficult riddle that she told us.
Yeah, I'll just say it one more time, if you haven't got it yet. So you go in through one hole, but you come out through three holes. And when you're in, you're ready to go outside, but when you're outside, you're still in. You've guessed it. Well, it is something that would keep you very cozy in the Scottish winters. It is a jumper or a sweater. Well, after all that brain work of remembering the riddle, I think it's almost time to put the kettle on and have a tea time treat. And today I've got something nice to eat here. I'll show you. I don't know if you can see this. This might be called something different where you are, but in Scotland they're called millionaire shortbreads. You might be able to see there are three layers. So it's shortbread and caramel and chocolate on the top. I have to admit, I didn't make these myself, but I know Anne is very good at baking. And so I'm sure she's got something tasty as well by her fireside.
Well, you're quite right. I've made a batch of scones. And they're wholemeal scones, so they're a bit like rock buns, actually. But I've got butter on them, and I've got rowan and apple jelly. So I'm going to eat those later, actually. But I'll show you the... This is the rowan jelly. And here's the jar. This is homemade rowan jelly. It's rowan and apple. And rowan, the botanical name is Sorbus aucuparia. And I find rowan a very interesting tree. It's a tree that's very connected with Scotland. And a lot of people say that it will protect us from evil spirits. And it's used for all sorts of things. The berries are very high in vitamin C. So the rowan jelly there is very nutritious. Also rowan wood, people were said to stir milk with it to stop milk curdling and to keep things in their, keep little rowan twigs in their pockets to protect them from, well, all sorts of bad things happening to them, but also it's meant to be helpful for arthritis or rheumatism. So yeah, the rowan tree is a very lovely thing to see and to think about. And there's a particular Scottish song that I discovered that's written by a songwriter who was probably has written almost as many songs for Scotland as Robbie Burns. Not quite as many as Robbie Burns, but quite a few quite famous songs. And her name was Carolina Oliphant. And she was a contemporary of Neil Gow, the Scottish fiddler. And she wrote a lot of songs. And one of the songs she wrote was called the Rowan Tree. I should say as well that she later married a Lord Nairn, so she became known as Lady Nairn. But this is a song by Lady Nairn called the Rowan Tree. And the traditional spinning wheel, which I have here, although I'm not sure it's that traditional that it's made of rowan wood, but traditionally the spinning wheel was made of rowan wood, and so you could spin away by the fire and have no fear of witches coming to get you, Maggie or anybody else. So here's a song about the rowan tree. Oh, rowan tree, oh, rowan tree, thou art so dear to me. Entwine thou art with money ties, a haymond infancy. Thy leaves were aye the first of spring, thy flowers the simmer's pride. There wisness sick a bonny tree, in all the countryside. O rowan tree, how fair wert thou in summer time, with all thy clusters white. Now rich and gay thy autumn dress with berries red and bright, and thy fair stem engraven were many names now ne'er I see. But here engraven on my head, forgot they ne'er can be. Oh, rowan tree.
Thank you, Anne. Well, we've been mentioning lots of different types of trees today, and just recently I've been collecting some conkers, I don't know if you can see that, from the horse chestnut tree in the local park here. I'm not very keen on spiders indoors, and so what I do is I put these on my windowsill because apparently the smell of conkers keeps the spiders away, and touch wood, I haven't seen any for a couple of weeks. If you've got any other ideas of keeping spiders from coming indoors, then you can let me know. But there are a lot of other creatures, small creatures, looking for berries and nuts from the trees to feed themselves during the winter. And one of those little creatures is the squirrel. So this squirrel here doesn't have a name. So if you've got any ideas for a suitable squirrel name, you could type it into the chat. And we might have a vote later on for the best name. But our next story is all about a little squirrel. It was harvest time, and Mummy Squirrel said to Little Squirrel, "Are you feeling brave today? There's something I'd like you to do." "Yes," said Little Squirrel. "What is it you want me to do?" "Well, it's the time of year where we need to be gathering the nuts, for the long winter is coming. Do you think you can help me to do that?"
"Yes, Mummy. Where do I need to go?"
"Well, you need to go through the forest, up the tallest tree, along the longest branch, over the dark pool, and there at the end of the branch you'll find the hazelnuts."
"Right, I'll go right away, Mummy," said Little Squirrel, and off he set.
He walked a little, and he skipped a little, and he ran a little, until he was in the middle of the forest. And he hadn't gone very far when he heard a sound. Do-it-do-woo! Do-it-do-woo! It was the big owl high up in the branches of the trees, looking down at Little Squirrel.
"Hello, Little Squirrel. What are you doing here in the dark forest? Are you not afraid? After all, you don't have my sharp claws to protect yourself."
No, I'm not afraid," said Little Squirrel. "In fact, I'm feeling very brave today. I'm out gathering the nuts for the winter time, and I have a long, long way to go, so I must be on my way. But goodbye, Owl."
"Goodbye, Little Squirrel," said Owl, "and good luck."
So Little Squirrel carried on his way, and he walked a little, and he skipped a little, and he ran a little, until at last he met the Red Fox.
"Little Squirrel, how are you today? Are you not afraid? After all, you're in the middle of the dark forest and you're all alone. And you don't have my sharp teeth to protect yourself."
"No," said Little Squirrel. No, I'm not afraid. I don't think I'm afraid. I'm just gathering nuts for the winter.
and I have a long way to go, so I must be on my way. Goodbye, Red Fox.
Goodbye, little squirrel, and good luck.
Why does everyone ask me if I'm afraid? Said little squirrel. What is there to be afraid of? And he carried on his way, and he walked a little, and he skipped a little, and he ran a little, until he met Rabbit. Little squirrel, what are you doing here? You're all alone and you're in the middle of the dark forest. Are you not afraid?
Afraid of what? Asked Squirrel.
Afraid of it.
It? Asked Little Squirrel.
Yes, it. You know, the thing in the dark pool.
The thing in the dark pool?
Yes. Did no one tell you about the thing in the dark pool?
No, no one told me about the thing in the pool, but I had to gather nuts for the winter, and so I must be on my way. Thank you, Rabbit. Goodbye.
Goodbye, little squirrel. Good luck.
Little squirrel, he didn't really want to go any further, but he promised his mummy he would get the nuts for the winter, and so he had to carry on. And so he walked a little, and he skipped a little, and he ran a little, until at last he saw the tallest tree in the forest, and he scampered up the trunk and along the longest branch until he got to the middle. I wish Rabbit hadn't told me about the thing in the pool, he said. He was a brave little squirrel, and so he took a deep breath and he looked down into the dark pool.
The thing in the pool, it looked at me. Oh, what shall I do? Maybe if I make an ugly face, it will scare the thing away. And so he made his ugliest face, and maybe you could help with this. And he looked down into the pool and he made his ugly face. But the thing in the pool made an ugly face back. Oh, what shall I do now? Said little squirrel. But he found a stick, and so he looked into the deep pool and he shook his stick at the thing. But the thing in the pool shook a stick back. Little squirrel, he found a stone and he threw it down at the thing in the pool. But you know, the thing in the pool threw a stone back at him. And little squirrel, he ran and he ran and he ran and he ran all the way down the trunk of the tree, and he ran past the rabbit and he ran past the red fox and he ran past the owl, and he didn't stop running until he got home. And his mummy said to him, "You're back soon. Did you get the hazelnuts?"
"No, Mummy, I didn't."
"You didn't get them? Why not?"
"Because of the thing in the pool. It made an ugly face at me, and it shook a stick at me, and it threw a stone at me. Oh, Mummy, I was so frightened."
"Well," said Mummy, "you know, if we don't get those hazelnuts, we're going to be very hungry this winter, so you'll just have to go back and get them."
"No," said little squirrel, "no, no, no, I can't go back."
"You'll have to go back," said Mummy Squirrel, "but this time, when you get to the dark pool, you look down and smile at the thing."
"Smile?"
"Yes. Smile at the thing in the pool, trust me, and see what happens." Little squirrel, he wasn't happy about going back to get those hazelnuts, but there was nothing for it, and so he walked a little, and he skipped a little, and he ran a little into the forest, And he ran past the owl. Hello, owl. He ran past the red fox. Hello, red fox. Ran past the rabbit. Hello, rabbit. Until he got to the tallest tree. And he scampered up the trunk until he came to the longest branch over the dark pool. He ran to the middle of the branch and he remembered what his mummy had said and he practiced his best smile. And he looked down into the pool and smiled at the thing. The thing in the pool, it smiled at me. And so he looked down and he waved at the thing in the pool. And the thing in the pool waved back. Oh, the thing in the pool is my friend, said little squirrel. And he ran to the end of the branch and he gathered as many hazelnuts as he could. And then he ran all the way back down the trunk and past the rabbit. Goodbye, rabbit. Past the red fox. Goodbye, red fox. Past the owl. Goodbye, owl. And when he got home, his mummy said, well, did you get the hazelnuts this time? Yes, mummy, I did. And guess what? The thing in the pool is my friend. That's very good, said mummy squirrel. Do you know who the thing in the pool is? Do you know who the thing in the pool is? Well, if you haven't guessed, the thing in the pool was a little squirrel's reflection. He was just looking at a picture of himself, like looking in a mirror. And that's the end of the story of Little Squirrel.